this way people would, you know, recognize me from my photograph in your, you know, flyer. But anyway, now I'll reveal the real Emiko.
Okay. Did you get that from the Monterey Bay Aquarium, or where did you get that mask?
It was a gift. I don't know where it came from.
Okay. Because I think I've seen, if it's a sea otter, I think I've seen the sea otter one from the Monterey Bay Aquarium.
This is a cat.
Oh, I'm sorry. Cat. Sorry. Sorry.
Gosh. Okay. Sorry. All right.
Okay. So hi. Welcome.
Welcome, everybody. Thanks for, you know, spending some time with us. I know there's a Warriors game coming up, but I hope you can record it.
Oh, they're in the playoffs anyway. So, you know. I'm not worried about them. They're in the playoffs. So I want to start with the very first sentence you wrote in your biography, which is your favorite Japanese title is I Was Born But. Is that, and you know, we've seen as part of our movie night program, we have seen some Ozu films. We haven't seen I Was Born But. Do you have, is that your all-time favorite Japanese film, or do you have other favorite Japanese films?
Oh, yeah, I hate, you know, I hate these questions of my favorites because I have many favorites. Kurosawa and, of course, Ozu. And anyway, I'm very bad at remembering names.
Yeah, sorry, yeah. I didn't mean to put you on the spot, but I just wanted to mention that Ozu's a big favorite of mine as well. And I assume that, you know, you have a wide range of influences in your filmmaking. And I feel like I see some of Ozu in your films, and maybe there are other filmmakers that have inspired you along the way that, as we talk, I hope they come up in conversation. Mm. I know the French filmmaker Chris Marker,
yes,
was an influence, and you knew him and you worked with him.
Yes.
So
I don't like to use like blessed, but I do feel blessed that I was able to make his acquaintance.
Well, so for people who don't know, you made a film in honor of him, in an homage to him.
Yes.
Called To Chris Marker, An Unsent Letter. This film, it's not really available. I mean, I was able to see it through you, but I looked far and wide for it. It's not that available. And so I want to ask also more broadly, how can people get access to more of your works?
Well, you know, I'm very bad at this kind of thing and having a website. I do, that movie does have a distributor, which completely slips my mind right now of what that distributor is. And I don't know if it's on streaming by that distributor. I'm kind of terrible when it comes to distribution. It's kind of like I make a film and then hopefully some people see it. I think it's kind of unfair to the films, you know what I mean? And the people I've made the films about, because it should be part of my job to try to get it out there. I mean, that's the reason of making it, you know, but anyway, so I'm remiss. I'll have to see about that. Yes.
Okay. Well, and your fans we have a nice fan base here, so I can also encourage them to contact libraries and other, you know, institutions and just say, hey, I want to see these films. And if they hear about it, then they'll think about acquiring them. I certainly think a lot of these films should be at libraries anyway. So so I'll just put that out there to all of our audience. So we can talk about your films more as we talk about it. But then to get back to I Was Born But, you were born in Poston.
No, I was born before Poston.
Before Poston. Yeah. Okay.
19, yeah.
So, you know, that has had quite you know, so by the time you left Poston, how old were you?
Let's see, 5 or 6, something like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, I mean, what an impact that had on you as a child and as a person then growing up, right? So, can you talk just a little bit about how your life was when your family got out of camp and how you returned to school and all that?
You know, I have very poor memory of any of that. I know it affected me, and the only way I can really think about it is the work that I do. Like, for instance, this one that we're going to show, it's called Little Rabbit. I mean, it's not called Little Rabbit. I call it Little Rabbit. It's called When Rabbit Left the Moon. And that came about for several reasons. One is it was coming upon the 75th anniversary of the signing of the executive order. That would have been, I do believe, in 2007. And I don't know, nothing really seemed to be being done about it in a big way. And I just thought, oh, I don't know, something needs to be done. Anyway, so I was what I call noodling, and I came up with this concept of, when I was making Rabbit in the Moon, I saw lots of archival footage, of which a lot of it is in the film. And I had this idea that the first time I saw that footage, it's very moving and emotional, but when you have like narration going over it and people talking and all that, it has a different effect on the audience. I don't think you're fully engaged with the picture when you're listening to music and narration and stuff like that. So I just wanted to make something where the viewer had the same experience I did of seeing this in the National Archives. It was sort of raw, you know, just to see this stuff. And so now it's not completely silent. There's music with it. So I have to admit that, you know, music is also kind of a voice, and maybe, you know, is trying to lead you somewhere. So I didn't have any resources, so I just mined Rabbit and found the footage, and the music comes from Rabbit, and I decided to try this like just a visual experience with the experience. And I'd always wanted to do a museum piece. Now, again, just because of pure luck and running into Mark Johnson, he introduced me to some people at the Asian Art Museum. So we were able to have this as an installation at the Asian Art Museum. And I always wanted to do an installation in a museum. So I went, okay, I get to do this. Also, I had been affected by another exhibit I had seen called The Clock. And that is composed of, it is a clock, it's a 24-hour clock, and that particular piece of video is made up of every minute of the day. He found a clip in a movie that was talking about that very minute, and he put all these clips together. So when you see all the clips, and it takes 24 hours to see it, you get, it's a completely immersive and unbelievably rich viewing experience. And he was very particular about it. He wanted he said he wanted this kind of sofa and there should be so many in the room and da da da, you know, so people could sit comfortably in sofas. So I went, okay, I just want this to be on a screen and I want some comfortable sofas in front of it. And that's how it was presented. I know we're getting a little out of order because we were going to start with the other movie, but I got into this movie. I'm so sorry.
That's
anyway,
okay.
And what I was finding, just thinking about tonight, were all these notes people left after the, you know, they would come through. There was no, you know, it was just music, the sofas, and the room was bare. I think we might have had something about executive order, you know, 9066, 75th anniversary, something like that, just a label, but nothing. I didn't, you know, anyway, so we didn't have a place for people to write notes at the beginning. And the museum people said, you know, people want to like leave notes and messages. So so I got a bunch of them. And so I thought, well, it was an experiment, but it worked. I think what happens, because here was another test. When friends saw it, and they all know my movie, Rabbit in the Moon, they said, where did you get all that footage? I said, well, it was all in Rabbit in the Moon. See, so you actually didn't see that footage in the way that now you were seeing it. Mm-hmm. And what was so great is I got like these messages from children saying, let's see, like, I don't know, something here like people should be all kind and don't hurt one another. And this was kind of a great note. It says, it has a little picture of a broken heart and it says, heart broken open, growing up on East Coast in 1950s through 1960s, no mention of this history. And she, you know, it was this little note. And it was, you know, I hadn't looked at these for a very long time. And it was like, oh my God, this is kind of great. It's, you know, anyway, so that's how the little rabbit came about. Mm-hmm. And I thought the title was appropriate if you saw when Big Rabbit, which is called Rabbit in the Moon, and Little Rabbit is called When Rabbit Left the Moon, because I think the camps were an attempt for us to kind of shed everything Japanese about us. And so I still see a rabbit in the moon, but it was just metaphorically speaking, by like we got kind of like whitewashed in the camp experience and came out like, you know, less Japanese than when we went in. So that's the explanation of those two movies.
You know, and I will show Little Rabbit in a minute, and we can talk more about that because I think it is kind of amazing when you realize that the footage is from Big Rabbit. It took me a while to say, okay. And the way you rework it and the way it ends up being more like a tone poem. It's like, it reminds me of a poem. I do want to talk to you a little bit about sort of the technical choices you made to go from one work to the other, but to go back into what you said about how the camp experience wanted Japanese Americans to, it sort of stigmatized Japanese American identity, right? So everybody felt like being Japanese American was wrong or was abhorrent for some reason. And so the children of that time grew up thinking, I don't want to be Japanese American, right? I don't want to appear that way because nobody's going to like me, or you know, I can't get a job or whatever.
Right.
So I just want to try to ask you maybe how you rediscovered your Japanese Americanness, and did studying film help you do that? Like, how did you transition to studying film and using that to sort of express your Japanese Americanness?
Well, I like to say that I came to film very late. I grew up in a small town in Southern California, a small farm town. There was one movie theater. Mostly we had to work on the farm and didn't have much time to go to the movies. And it was kind of like Hollywood movies. And for a long time, I didn't know what the name of our theater was. It was called the Avo Theater. Then later on, I said, oh, I get it. See, I came from Vista, which called itself the avocado capital of the world. So anyway, I came up here to go to school at Berkeley because both my sister and my brother were at Berkeley. And it was here, when I got to Berkeley, that I started actually seeing real movies. There were these tiny theaters on Telegraph Avenue, and they were showing foreign films. Pauline Kael got her start there, writing, blurbs for the movies. Mm-hmm. And I remember it was like, wow, movies can actually tell important things about life, and they were beautiful. So that's my introduction was, I was already, 18, 19 or something when I came up here. Oh, 20, I was 20. And then I transferred to San Francisco State because Cal was a gigantic school. I was not used to these gigantic classes. And I came from, a small school, and I went to 2 years of junior college in a small college. And so coming to this giant campus and everything. Anyhow, so I ended up transferring over to San Francisco State. And how I got into the film department, I have to admit, was again, kind of later in my college career. I was floundering about in college, not knowing what I wanted to do with my life. College was sort of going on and on. And somebody said, if you really want to get some easy grades, you should join the film department. I went, okay, that's for me. So I joined the film department, and I had tried still photography in the art department. I'm not very good at still photography. You have to have lots of patience, and you have to be alert every second of your life, just in case, And so that wasn't kind of like my style. And then I discovered the motion picture camera and the storytelling aspects of these images that, were contiguous. I still tend to take stills that way and start, with iPhone and stuff. You take a bunch of the same thing, making a little story out of it. There might have been one other, maybe possibly two other women in my film classes. There just weren't very many of us. And at San Francisco State at that time, we weren't even a film department. We were part of broadcast communications or something like that. Anyway, and while I was there, we wanted our own department. We really felt we were better than the broadcast department and the broadcast. We were not interested in TV, We wanted to make movies. So we split off and we started our own department. I had to work my way through all this. And so I had part-time, one of my student jobs was to work in the equipment cage, where I really learned all about equipment, which is very, very helpful. And then I graduated in, 1967 or something. And 1968, a friend of mine from school said, they're looking for an editor over at KQED on this new program called Newsroom. Now, Newsroom had come out of a newspaper strike that had happened earlier that year, where They started this, it looks like a newsroom, and it had this horseshoe-shaped table, and there was a host in the middle, and there were all these journalists, and they were journalists from the local papers, since the papers were on strike, and they'd come and they'd read their articles on television, and it was live television. I think it was Ford Foundation gave them money to continue after the strike was over, because it was a kind of a nice, you know, you had many different points of view. It wasn't just like one person talking to you, which was how news was presented in those days. I think it was like Walter Cronkite or something. That was it. So this was a live program where these various journalists were there, and they would have like conversations, discussions to talk about their stories. And they had this film part of it. Now, mind you, none of us had ever done any of this stuff. But anyway, when I went to interview for the job, one of the questions was, you know, have you ever shot news before or done this kind of work before? And I thought, well, I guess this is going to be the end of the interview. I said, no. And they said, great. We want to be different from the other stations. And so we're so happy you don't have that experience. And so, you know, and so we had to be creative when we went on and shot. And it was film, you know, and it had to be processed. Our lab was across town, right around rush hour. We had to drive over and get our film there and bring it back. And we had to edit it and had to be on the air that night. So I didn't go to graduate school, but I've always felt that newsroom was my graduate school. Oh, you know, doing that, I did it for a little over a year, and it was like five nights a week. So it was like live television five nights a week. It was like being the theater or something. And we had a lot of screw ups because none of us were experienced at doing this kind of thing. And but we had quite a following because, you know, we were kind of a goofy thing going on. And one of the famous moments was when S.I. Hayakawa, you know, the San Francisco strike was going on, and S.I. Hayakawa came in to be interviewed live on, and he was so furious at us and the way we covered it that he got up and he stomped out of the room. Mayor Alioto had a show that came after us like one day a week. So sometimes he'd be in the control room and, you know, it was alive and wonderful. I mean, I had such a good time. It was also completely frightening. I'd never done any of this stuff before. Often I would go to a press conference. There would be like a bunch of guys. Luckily, I had this wonderful audio guy, Peter Hobie, who was quite large. He would elbow his way up to some spot. He'd put down the tripod and then I would come in. So we had a little thing going because, you know, it was, you've seen those where there was just a bunch of cameramen all over the place, you know, and you're trying to elbow your way in and all that. So anyway, like I said, it was a real life learning experience. And it was at a time up here where there was People's Park over at Berkeley was going on, you know, with a lot of like police and tear gas. There was anti-war stuff going on. There was a strike going on. And then of course there's like hippies coming in and there's stuff going on in the park. It was, you know, just a wild time to be out there. So I am forever grateful for that experience. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And after me, by the way, they hired other women. So a lot of women came out of that. Although I remember I went to cover one story about women's lib over at UC Berkeley. And I think it was something like, you know, being able to, I can't remember what it was. Anyway, integrate some sporting thing. I've forgotten now. Anyway, and I had worked with a bunch of very leftist liberal journalists. And they just made fun of this whole movement. I was like, wait a minute, you know, women wanting to, you know, do all these things. Anyway, so it was the very beginning of that as well. So there was just, you know, a lot of really intense, exciting things going on. You know, we went to the moon, the Black Panthers were going on. I mean, there was something going on all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, what a great time,
yeah,
actually.
To
be young and—
Yeah, really.
Yeah, trying new things. So I think this is a great opportunity to show the short about you. I love this. I'm so glad you shared it with me. It is a short film, about 6 minutes. You can intro it.
Can I intro it?
Yeah.
Why it exists even?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, around that time, I remember I was given an assignment to do something on a woman in an interesting profession. Now, and there were a few other people doing, given the same assignment. So, you know, you had your kind of like exotic dancer and stuff like that, right? And I was thinking, gee, and I went, well, wait, I'm in a pretty, you know, exotic profession for a woman. So so my friend Dorothy, who's in the movie, she and I cooked up this little movie about me being a camera person in the news department in 1969. And for some wondrous reason, we have it. And I mean, I still have it because we made it, you know, how many years ago? Mm-hmm. So thank you for showing it.
Yeah, no, I love it. And so it's I think people are going to get a real kick out of this. This was Women's Lib in the late 60s. I think people will get a big kick out of what was considered Women's Lib back then. And we can talk about maybe what we think about it now. So let me do share screen and hopefully it will work.
I'm loading film, don't come in.
Do you think we'll get close to him so that I can put a lavalier around his neck?
Probably. We'll probably be in a very small room.
Well, I think I'll take a Sennheiser and we can just stick it at him if we can.
And but we're not taking a tripod.
How many magazines are you shooting?
Two,
that's okay. I think my battery's okay. Let me check it.
Okay, let's run a test.
1, 2, 3, testing, 1, 2, 3. Oh, fine, that's good.
I don't know about my battery.
I think I became interested in cinematography because it allowed you to be in a lot of places that you didn't think you should be in. And this has to do with being a woman, too. Like, I wanted to be in a pool hall, but you can't just walk in. There's really nothing that says you can't, except whatever you were taught. I feel very unique in that I'm the first woman news camera lady that I know of and that I've ever seen. And I think that there has to be some readjustment of people's thinking. We always get comments whenever I've got on a job, especially with two other men, sound man and reporter, about my having to carry the biggest load and all that. I think it's a slightly chauvinistic remark. It may not be, just maybe a smart remark. But I get the feeling sometimes that it is, like I ought not to be carrying a camera, period. I don't go out on jobs that they think there's going to be violence, a great deal of violence, simply for my own protection. I kind of resented that at first, but I appreciate that now because I did go out on one job and it was very frightening. And if I were to trip and fall, and I'd probably get trampled or something, I mean, I can see then where physical stamina and physical strength would be kind of important. There are certain things unique in my situation, and one of those unique things is being 5 feet tall and 100 pounds. Unless they get the equipment down to about half its present weight, I myself don't think I can compete. Not on a level of competency, just simply on a level of physical stamina. Also, being short in this field is sort of disadvantageous. There is people's heads in your way. But we have had new views of things, I am told, with low angle views. Not many people see from my point of view. I discovered that. And so everybody, you know, when they first saw my footage, thought, wow, she really has a different eye.
A fight for you. It is a fight against the new makeup.
All these years we've looked at news and almost all documentary films through the eyes of men. There are differences in the way men and women see. I couldn't name them to you, but I really think there are. I can't tell you now because there aren't enough women in the field to say that there's any significant difference. A lot of people think I'm a uniquely liberated woman because I've sort of broken some kind of barrier. Well, I really never intended to break a barrier. I wasn't on some kind of campaign to integrate the filmmakers union. It's sort of incidental now that I'm here. What I have found is women are perfectly capable of doing this work. It's interesting, it pays well, and I'm very, very sorry that more women aren't in it. A lot of women are afraid of it. I think that's a social kind of stigma, afraid of machines, just seeing this object with all its gears and wheels and things like that scares them off. But anyway, if my example can help other women strive to try to break into this field, that's great.
How do you feel about women as cameramen in this business? What's funny about that question? Is that a funny question?
I realize that I have a hard time answering that. A woman is a cameraman. If a woman is a cameraman, camerawoman can work fully with her equipment, then I think that's superb.
I think women would make superior filmmakers to men. Assuming that they decrease the weight of the equipment so that the women can carry it comfortably, because I think their orientation is more visual than men.
I think it's fine as long as they can carry the camera and support it all right. I think it's an area that they belong in just as much as anything else, as much as men.
Originally, I was quite concerned that our female filmmakers weren't doing a satisfactory job, but in the past 6 months, they've seemed to have learned a lot, or through experience have been developing into very capable filmmakers.
The same way I feel about women as anything. Anything's possible.
I think they're great.
I think they're lovely, especially Emiko, who also can carry the camera.
I think that we should have more women as filmmakers.
I've always enjoyed looking at movies, but this is the first time I enjoy looking at movie makers.
Okay, thank you.
I like that.
Go ahead, you guys, go in the door.
Here, go
in the door.
You're going to lose your cable or something.
Okay. Look at you. That was that was so great. Have you seen this recently?
No.
Okay. What did you think seeing it again?
It's kind of embarrassing.
Oh, I think it's great.
I mean, how, you know, those were like, I mean, those comments made by, you know, like one of the one guy who couldn't, like the very first guy who said, you know, you can't, he hadn't thought about it. Well, he was a cameraman too. I was his senior because I got hired before him. But it was like, really? I just didn't know that these guys were thinking like this. I mean, these are the guys I worked with and they were all wonderful people. And in fact, the black guy, there were two. There were the two men and Alan Willis was the black guy. I had to talk to two people and he was one of them to be hired. So he hired me. anyway, there were a lot of things. It's also not only just about the movie and the fact about, I don't know, where feminism was at that time or where I was at that time. I mean, you know, it's kind of like I go, oh, it sounds kind of chauvinistic. Well, duh, you know? So anyway, well, like I say, you know, I really never went into it with any of these thoughts, you know, so now like they're all being like, oh, well, okay, let me think about that. And yes, there was sexism and all that going on. And the other woman that you saw shooting, that was my friend Dorothy. So she helped me make that film. And really after me, there were a number of women. I mean, I have to take my hat off to them because they did hire women. And, you know, if we could do the job, we kept on it, you know. Anyway, so it just was a blast from the past, including the times, you know, all of, like I said, there were all those things going on. Mm-hmm. I forgot about Mick Jagger and Bobby Seale, and, you know, anyway. Mm-hmm. So yeah.
It's a great piece of history. We have to figure out a way to get this out so more people can see it. I love it. And I want to encourage people to write in the chat any reactions you have to any of the videos or anything that we're talking about tonight, and also put in any questions. We're happy to take questions.
Okay, too. So they can't ask questions. It has to be.
Oh no, they can. We'll have a Q&A period too.
Okay,
at
great.
Some point for everybody. Just while we're talking and while they're watching the video, they can also put comments into the chat. We have a couple already. So I love that. But one thing I wanted to ask you about was, do you think? Well, I would imagine camera equipment has changed quite a bit.
Well, right? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So now that is no longer a hindrance, right? I mean, camera equipment should be pretty easy to handle for anybody, right?
Yeah, right. No kidding. You know, these phones make fabulous movies. You know, I use it myself. Now when I think about it and they're saying, oh, if they can get the equipment down, well, you know, it has shrunk. And we shot in black and white, which I love. And the camera that I was loading, that's called a single system camera. So that sound would be, you know, recorded on that. That's what news cameras were. It was fairly early in this sort of portable 16 millimeter stuff. So lots of things were being just developed at that time. And then, you know, having to change to video I was just a snob about it for a long time, but now I love it. And of course, video these days is just getting so amazingly wonderful technically and all that. So, and editing digitally is so much more, it has its ups and its downs. The upside is, you know, in film, we actually had to physically cut it. And so sometimes if you lost a frame or something, you'd have to like find it. Whereas, you know, with digital, it's all still there. That's kind of so wonderful. But on the other hand, sometimes things happen too quickly. Like, you know, when you had to like look for stuff from your reel, you're just looking through it and then you'll like, you kind of maybe find something you'd like forgot about, you know. But with digital, you know, it's kind of like you type something in and it comes up, you know. So, but they're just different tools. And now I'm really happy that I can, because it makes me, I can do it all myself practically. You know, before it was like film was expensive. You had to have a process and you had to have this work print made, which was a print of the original. And then you cut it and then you had to have the conform that to the original. And then you had to have it printed and you kind of like, you know, everybody took a guess at what it might look like. You know, so but now it's kind of all there. You can just sort of see it. It's in front of you. And when I first was starting to use video, when I shot with my motion picture camera, I didn't even think about this until video came along, that it's kind of an intimate experience with you and this machine. Well, I don't like to call it a machine. Anyway, this wonderful thing that, and then you're trying to do things with that camera that it's just you and it. Well, when digital video came in, they started having monitors. And so everybody could see what you were doing. And I didn't like that because it seemed like this is my art and I didn't want all these other people kind of critiquing it or blah, blah, blah. But now, especially if you are working a job, it's nice because they know what they're getting. You know, with film, you didn't know. It had to go get processed. I remember I had a work trip to Africa. I had suitcase full of 16 millimeter film and of course we weren't going to know what we had on that at all until we got back and it got processed. And so it made you have to be pretty exact about things with a light meter, and you only had 10 minute rolls. And so you had to be kind of exact about, you know, an interview or something, you know. So at first it was disconcerting to realize now you could have interviews that just went on and on. I mean, like a couple of hours if you wanted, you know. And then the other thing that came with video and digital videos is people started experimenting with, like, one of my all-time favorite movies is called Time Code. And it's was made by a British director named Mike Figgis. And he, it's in four screens. And he always wanted to make a movie with one shot, which Alfred Hitchcock did. It wasn't one shot because he still had only certain limits to the amount. You know, there was no film camera that could, you know, roll for like an hour and a half, right? Mm-hmm. Anyway, so when this happened, Mike Figgis, so rope, which is really a bunch of things strung together, it's very awkward. It doesn't work well. Anyway, so Mike Figgis decided to do this, and he shot with four cameras, and there were four screens. And I remember the thought of, like, oh my gosh, I'm going to have to watch four screens. It's going to make me crazy. But it was really a trip. It was kind of like the cubist view of life, because what you saw, because they were all in like one building. And so you saw things from different perspectives from these four cameras. And then every once in a while, everything intersected, like somebody came from this frame and walked into that frame. And he wrote it, he's a musician, and he wrote that down as music because he couldn't really figure out how to script it. So everybody worked by time on their watches, and like it was like a piece of music. So they all had to be at a certain point, located at a certain time. So in some ways it's like, ooh, it sounds sort of technical and isn't going to be stiff and awful. But what it did for the actors was it was like being in a play. It was live, and maybe it wasn't always on them, but they never knew exactly when it was going to be on them. So everybody had to like stay in character, you know. And I think I've forgotten how many takes he did when he was finally satisfied. And the reason it worked better than rope is because you had four screens. Otherwise you had the same problems of, like, if something's taking a long time for somebody to walk from here to there, if you just let it roll, it's like dead time, you know. But with four screens, and basically he guided the way you viewed it with the soundtrack. So anyway, that was, you know, exciting things could happen that you couldn't do in film. And that's been what's been a lot of fun with video. And it did help, like, if you're going to cover something, you know, like an event or a demonstration or something, that you could have like these, something that ran for an hour. That was like a godsend, because, you know, you wouldn't miss any of the action. Mm-hmm. It could be like you could be conduct with film, you know, you'd be conducting an interview and you'd start to see your footage counter going down, and they hadn't come to the end of their answer yet. It was like very, so we used to just waste film. Like, okay, we have to cut and we're not going to do another take. Then we, you know, we have to put up more film. But so those were just some of the things about the transition. I still think film is beautiful, but it's okay.
Well, so then you did have a pretty rich career after that. I'm sorry we won't have a whole lot of time to talk through all of your films, but you left Newsroom and became a freelancer, right? From 1972, I believe. And so you started to make a bunch of different films, and I just want to point out to people that you made a breadth of films. You might, you know, I don't want people to think you were shoehorned into any one thing or another. It seems like you handled a wide range of interesting topics, including a fictional narrative. So I do want to mention that you made The Departure, which is based on a short story. And then you also made Hot Summer Winds for, was that for American Playhouse?
Yes.
Yes. And that takes two short stories by Hisae Yamamoto.
Yeah.
And thank you for sharing that with me. I think that's also really beautiful. And hopefully later this summer, we'll figure out a way that we can show that and maybe talk to you about that in particular. But I do want to move on to maybe, you know, Big Rabbit and Little Rabbit. And just to start to talk about... I don't know if you want to talk a little bit about how you got started with Big Rabbit, and then we can sort of move on to Little Rabbit and show that feature, that short.
Ah, well, actually I had just finished Hot Summer Winds. Well, not just finished, but you know, and it wasn't long thereafter because I finished that one in 19... Let's see. I think it was 1990. And what had happened was reparations had happened. Mm-hmm. And my sister, Shimizu, who I hope is somewhere on this, she got involved with the movement. She lived in Seattle at that time. And when the commission hearings were going on, she just, like, okay, both of us had really not looked at the camps, or, you know, we up to then, we hadn't, we just put it behind us, our whole family put it behind us, we just didn't talk about it. Pretty typical. But the hearings really got everyone going, I think. And anyway, my sister, we'd talk and she'd go, you know, I found out this and this and this. It's like, really? What? That's awful, you know, blah, blah. And anyway, so it was sort of, all this new information was coming out. And we would say, well, God, somebody ought to make a movie about this. And, you know, it because I wanted to do fiction. I just finished this wonderful fiction piece and I'm going to move into fiction. But then this camp stuff came up. And then eventually it was kind of like, well, who better to make it than two of us who were there? and that's really, I think it came out of the commission hearings. I would say that. I think that's what got Shimizu thinking about it. In fact, the whole community and the whole kind of country started taking a look at that and what happened and everything because of those hearings. I'm just going to get on my soapbox just very briefly here to say, you know, we do want to support Black reparations, which came directly out of our reparations. So we're doing some work around that, you know, just writing Congress people and stuff. Actually, it got out of committee.
Ooh.
It got introduced in 1989.
That's right.
By John Conyers.
Mm-hmm.
And then he, see, this is right. The woman who brought it back, I forgot, because he he left. So anyway, so we're trying to help out with that. It's very, of course, complicated and controversial. Okay. So really, you know, she just started, well, I think one of the main things she talked about, which we hadn't really looked at or thought about, was a questionnaire. And and we had this wonderful, well, many wonderful friends, because I wish Shimizu would get on, because she would know, you know, because she was part of a class action suit, she was doing all this research, and she met all these people like Eiko Herzig and just about everybody in the movie she met. Then Eiko would just, she was, you know, her knowledge was vast, and she had boxes of stuff. And if you asked for something, you got reams of stuff. And, you know, it just got us going. And then, and the questionnaire in particular, because I think it was one of the worst things that happened to our community in camp, because it really made you have to make a choice. It divided people, blah, 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 blah. And so, you know, we started off doing that. And it took a long time to finish for this, all the same reasons that films take a long time. You know, you got to stop and raise money, blah, blah. And you know, we did get answers like, I think it was American Experience, we were pitching it, and they said something like, oh, you know, we've done that story. I think they'd done like, maybe it was Lisa Yasui's piece, I don't know. Oh, and one called Nelly and Mitsue. That was it. That was like 1 hour of programming. Shimizu wrote most of the grants. I will say thank you, Shimizu. And she persisted. And you know, we had these wonderful interviews, because at that time, I think the resistors were just starting to speak up very publicly. And I think that's thanks to like Frank Chin and Frank Abe and people like that. So these were parts of the experience that not many people had heard about. The draft resistance in the camps, and the kind of other like the Manzanar, let's see, what do we call that? The Manzanar protest. It's called other words, like, you know, protests are, that's what it was. And anyway, we just met a lot of wonderful people who were very knowledgeable and willing. That's the other thing. And willing to tell their stories, you know? And so I was interested in kind of the women's point of view. And when I thought about it, like, imagine being a woman, a lot of them were pregnant or had infants or, you know what I mean? My gosh, you're going to these places. And so, and I had been influenced by the writings of Primo Levi, who was a Holocaust survivor, and the way he described things. And of course I was influenced by Chris Marker, but I wanted to make a movie about the camps where people learn some new things. And here was all this new stuff. So it was just the time was right. And oh, I'm so happy, because almost all those people are gone now. Shimizu might be the last one in it. It is just so, so wonderful to see those people. And anyhow, so that's how Rabbit got made.
Good.
And I made a rule for myself, because I'd been working a lot in public television, meaning I was shooting things for people. I mean, I wasn't myself making real, you know, programs, but I would, I came to realize that most movies about the camps made at that, because see, Rabbit was finished in 1999. Mm-hmm. That there were kind of, they would always have like historians and scholars explaining what happened. I went, hey, we're still alive here. You know what? Let's just tell it ourselves. So everyone in that movie, whoever was going to be in, had to have either been in a camp, like, or Ernest Bessig, who actually did go to the camps from the ACLU, you know, and it's kind of like, why? We don't need interpretation. We got the real deal here, you know? So that was a good choice, I think. And I think it helps its authenticity. And in some ways, since I made it a personal film, which is, you know, my voice and the journey and everything, we didn't have to, like, it wasn't a journalistic piece. So I call it more like a memoir. And at that time, there were all the camps. I only went because I could only afford to go to three camps. Went to Heart Mountain, Manzanar, and Tule Lake. And none of them had been developed. So it was just the raw desert, the remnants of stuff was there. And by the way, this is an aside, I did go to the first Manzanar pilgrimage, which I shot for another movie, and I don't know what's ever happened to that movie, but it was when I was working for Newsroom, and I could take the equipment from Newsroom. So it was 1969 or 68 or 69 might have been the first pilgrimage, but a bunch of students to Manzanar. But anyway, like one of my favorite shots, I think it's in both, I think it's in Little Rabbit too. It's all that crockery that was in the desert. Now I went, and there was just something about it, kind of represented like life and people and all that, you know. And this is what I understand why all that broken crockery was there, is that the military didn't know what to do with it, or didn't maybe want other people to use it, because we had, I don't know, they broke all that crockery and just left it there. I think it's gone now. It was just a very raw and haunting. And here were some challenges I had. There'd been a lot of movies made where you actually went to Manzanar and you saw that a big obelisk and all that, you know. So I had to keep thinking of ways, like how would I shoot these things so they were different or from a different perspective. And then when I got out there, there were things like graves, you know, with little tombstones and stuff. And people had left little things there, like folded cranes and stuff, you know. And it was very haunting to be there and see like the foundations of things. I have to admit to one trickery we did, which was, you know, everybody talked about the wind. And it was windy, but it's really hard to show it. I mean, you know, there wasn't like a lot of trees and things out there. So that shot where the tumbleweed goes we did throw that through the shot.
Oh, okay. I was wondering about that.
I have to admit to that. This is the first time I have ever admitted this publicly.
Oh.
But, you know, it's like this. How do you visualize these things? You know, people talked about these things. And then... luckily, this fabulous home movie footage became available at Janum.
Yeah.
And so there was like the dust storms and, you know, stuff, you know, they were all there. Because if you go to the National Archives, I'd say 90% or 95% are people having a good time. I mean, there were boxes and boxes of photographs and there were baseball games and, you know, all these meetings and stuff like that, you know. So it kind of goes to this other thing of the insider-outsider perspective, and that is there was this whole movies, you know, taken in camp. The other thing was all these wonderful home movies before camp became available. See, our family didn't have any of that stuff. I didn't know about it. So that became available, and it became very important to show that, to know what we lost. And again, it had been visual, it had been verbalized by many people, oh, we lost this, and we lost the farm, we lost. But to see that what a vibrant community was like, there's, and I was specific about shots. There's like one shot where it's like some picnic thing is going on, but in the background, there's like rows of automobiles, people were doing okay. I mean, doing well, you know? So that was important, because the other thing that became apparent working with my sister, who's 10 years older than I am. So she experienced pre-war Japanese community, Japanese American community, which I didn't. And there really was a difference between her experience and my experience. So even for me, seeing that footage, it's like, wow, you know, people are dressed up and they're, you know, they were doing well. Mm-hmm. It is still hard for me personally to try to really feel the loss or what happened, you know, like, I try to imagine it now, like, you know, if somebody came and just suddenly took everything and said, you know, report here and all that. I can't really, I don't know. But I'm always working visually to try to do that. And one of the reasons there are these sort of long pans in Rabbit, which I didn't shoot that way for when I worked for other people, because almost nobody ever used long pans or whatever, or zooms, like the one with the dishes, you know. But I decided, I didn't really decide, but this is just the way I am anyway. I like to shoot things slowly and all. Anyway, so when people talked about the desert or whatever, again, it was like how to visualize this stuff for people. And so I'm really glad I went there before it was all spiffied up, you know, because it was just, it was, like I say, raw feeling. And so I did those long pans so that you would know what kind of landscape that, so even though I didn't go to all the camps, it was representative of kind of the places they picked for all the camps, you know, could be, you know, extreme weather. You know, I'm kind of sorry I didn't go to Arkansas, but oh well, you know, budgetary limits.
Yeah.
And then I was out. And then, because we shot that film on a bigger format, it's called Beta, but little cameras were just coming out. And so I wanted to do some experimentation. So I did, like the teeth falling and stuff. That's all me just screwing around with this equipment, because now I could do it all myself. So I try to do that in every one of my little films. I try to put something kind of unique and goofy or whatever. But anyway, so that's the genesis. And just aside, we never even thought about JACL, but when we did these interviews, they came up in every interview, because guess who we were talking to? We were talking to the resistors. We were talking to the anti-camp, you know, administration people. And it all kind of led to JACL, especially with the draft resistance. And so that's how really it came up. And, you know, so that's how it came to be in our movie. Well, of course, JACL was not happy with us, but they've come around.
Well, great. I thank you for that. That's, I've learned a lot, actually. I've seen Rabbit in the Moon several times, but it's always great to hear from the filmmaker and hear some of this sort of inside stuff. Maybe we can have you back sometime and we can sort of go in depth into it. I want to do a couple things before I show our videos. One is to do a shout out to Shimizu Omori, who is in the audience. So hey, Shimizu. And also shout out, you mentioned home movies. So I just want to mention Bob Nakamura and yes. Karen Ishizuka.
Yes.
For their footage and their, yes. their work.
Yes, for, and preserving all that wonderful yeah. stuff at yeah. the museum.
Thank you.
Glad to be rejoined by Emiko, and then also joined by our special guests, Hiroshi Shimizu, Kaz Naganuma, and Hiroshi Fukuda. Thank you so much for joining us, and thanks for showing up tonight. First, I want to ask how are you all doing? Are you all getting through this past year okay?
Yeah.
Yes.
It was a vaccination.
Right.
Good. Good. So we'll welcome questions. You can either write them in the chat or maybe raise your hand or just kind of yell out, and you can ask a question about anything that we've talked about tonight. But I'll start off with a couple of questions. First, to the three amigos, that video that we just watched, Then Becoming Now, that was from 2019. So I assume you've seen this documentary, and I want to get your thoughts about it. But also, have you been staying active in the past couple of years, maybe with Sudo for Solidarity or for other organizations? What have you been able to do, even though we've been in lockdown for the past year?
Well, let me get something started. I know Hiroshi Shimizu, Shim, you're very involved with the Tule Lake Pilgrimage Committee, right?
Right.
And Crystal City.
Yeah, after that pilgrimage and protest at Dili, that same year in October, October, November, we held just a pure Crystal City pilgrimage. So Kaz and I were co-chairs for that. And so that kept us really busy through 2019. And then sometime through that period, we worked with you to put Them Becoming Now together. And at the beginning of 2020, at Kenji Taguma's Films of Remembrance, the film was shown. And I think the last time we had a kind of a social gathering was when the four of us went to the showing in San Jose. And I believe that was the last time we had we were together physically.
There's
it is.
Why don't you talk about the, because that was the first time you'd been back to Crystal City, all of you, right? Was that the first time since leaving it? And what was your, you know, feelings about going back and being there? You know? Cause?
For me, it was important because I was too young to remember so many things, and everything I know is really from what my mom or my dad told me or my older siblings. So to go there was really important for me. And what was nice is that my two sons and my nephews and my two brothers that are still living were all able to go. That was pretty special. I was a co-chair, but you know, that the pilgrimage, that was the first one I had been to. And I wouldn't have been a co-chair unless Shim was the other co-chair, because he knows everything about pilgrimages. I had zero experience. So I thank him for his guidance. But it was special just because we're all getting along in our years. I wanted my family to get a better sense of what took place. That's what I've been doing, is really been busy gathering family photos and just gathering things that I could organize and pass on to my son's daughter, nephews, nieces, because they're all quite hungry for something that's just put together that, and organized. You know, they have bits and pieces, but I'm trying to get it together. That's what kept me busy, and I'm still involved quite a bit, actually, getting things together. So that pilgrimage was important.
Well, you know, for me, you guys all were here in the San Francisco Bay Area. You came back, or you didn't come back, but you came here. And it was a learning experience for me to realize how, because I went back to a small farm town. There weren't that many Japanese Americans there. But to learn about Reverend Fukuda and all that he did, and, you know, he wrote a, would you call, it was a memoir, right, Hiroshi? Would it be a memoir? You know, my 6 years of internment.
Yes.
And how the role that he played, you know, in the various camps that he was in, and then afterwards. You know, your father was a very remarkable man.
Well, it's amazing these days, the Japanese community, Japantown, Yomachi, it was quite large in the population. You know, now there's only a scattering of Japanese people in Japantown. Well, before, you know, there was a large population. You know, we all went to school in Japantown. Well, over half the people went to Rayford Wheel, and the other half went to Pacific Heights. Now, you know, when I say Pacific Heights in these days, in this context, you know, people think of middle class, upper middle class. Well, in those days, it wasn't like that. It wasn't like that at all. It was more of an extension of the Western tradition. And yeah, so anyway, after all these years, we still get together. And matter of fact, we're planning to get together next month. It's amazing how your childhood friends from Boy Scouts could stay together for such a long time.
And we're very lucky, actually. Yeah. Go ahead, Hiroshi.
So I want to add that when you made this video, I think each of us must have had, 40 minutes or an hour or whatever it was? And, I was amazed to see the final production. And I'm glad you made me come out somewhat recently.
Yeah, just a did thank amazing you job. To, yeah, I agree. You know, thank you to Emiko, Nancy Ukai, and the radio station KALW.
Yeah.
You guys did a wonderful job. I've shown it to all my relatives, but other people that have no idea about our experience, when they see that, they get it. And that's how well it's done. They get it. So thank you for that.
Well, thank you. I mean, as I say, I'd like to introduce something new about the camps if I'm gonna make another film about the camps. And in this case, of course, not many people still know about Peru and other, you know, Latin American Japanese that were kidnapped and brought up here. So that's an important story to go out. And I also wanted to show, to me, because the camps were just an absurd waste of money, that they were doing things like schlepping people to all these different places, like Shim's family, you know. But anyway, I learned a lot about how different it was for you all to come back to this community in San Francisco, that it was still a community, kind of, you know, putting itself back together, and how important the Boy Scouts were. I had no idea.
Now, let me add here that when we all returned to, we didn't actually return, Hiroshi did, but when I came to San Francisco for the first time and when Kaz did, we lived in closer proximity to each other than we did at Crystal City, because I lived on Laguna Street, Kaz is across the street, and right around the corner was the Concord Church. So we were like within, you know, across the street and a half a block around the corner from each other. And, you know, that and the Boy Scouts is what contributed to our bonding as kids.
Well, I regret now that I didn't do this, which was to identify, because both Kaz's father and Hiroshi's father is in that footage. They're like drinking at the Concord Church. They seem like they like to have a good time.
Yes, we did. Yeah. They did. Some of the Sunday services, the main celebrations, the grand ceremony, used to run from the morning until late afternoon. We used to have a service, then a luncheon, and then sometimes a program.
And of course, there's a basketball court.
Right. That was our playground, you know.
Yeah. Shims, so what were your first reactions going back to Crystal City? You remember, you have the best memory of all of us. You know, you remember things like,
sure,
since you were really young.
Yeah, I, you know, I remember, for instance, that my parents had ordered through Montgomery Ward a pair of those metal skates, the ones that you tighten up onto your shoes. Mm-hmm. And at Crystal City, I was 4 years old. So I wasn't quite ready for skates. And I remember Hiroshi was just the right age and he got really good. And I was so jealous of how good he's skating.
Thank you.
And then on the trip to Crystal City, the plane trip to San Antonio, Kaz's brother was remembering when I was in the pool with him and how I had to jump up and down so that I could breathe. And, he actually mimicked that, up, yeah. You know, the hopping that I had to do. So, yeah, it was yeah, really wonderful coming back, coming around.
Well, speaking about the pool, there's, you know, there's a couple of interesting stories about it. Why don't you guys tell the story about, you know, the little girls in that pool, which wasn't really a pool, it was just sort of a pond.
It was actually a really big pool. Shim, was it a reservoir before that?
Yeah, well, it was a reservoir.
Right.
And, yeah, and then one end of it they roped off, but it, I think it sloped down steeply at in the midpoint of the area that was marked off for swimming, and two Peruvian girls. They were, I think, what, 10 and 11. I think they were walking near the edge of where it really sloped down, and then there was that buildup of algae, and they slipped and then they went under. Mm. And yeah, that was a, you know, one of the really traumatic events at Crystal City. It affected everybody, you know, because they were kids, it affected all the kids, and the parents were really cautious after that.
One of my brothers told me that, one of our sister that was about the same age knew them. So I don't know how she took it at that time, but it must have been traumatic.
And what about, you know, when we went back, what, now don't you each have a piece of that pool? Was iconic. That pool was iconic, right?
Arturo Gonzalez gave us a piece of the bottom of the pool, the piece of concrete. He had that for a while, the pieces, that is, because they demolished the pool, and he thought it was a good idea just to keep it. And he's kind of a historian himself, so he kept that. So when we arrived there, he gave us a piece of the pool. And I was able to put it into a case for both Hiroshi's and myself to just keep it as a showpiece, because that's the only, for me or our family, that's the only thing I have of the Crystal City camp. So that was pretty special, yeah. Just a little concrete piece. Yeah.
Well, can you talk a little bit about, well, either one of you, but about how we were received by the town, Crystal City, when we went? Or actually more about, like, they talked a little bit about the relationship they had with the, when we were there in the camps, you know, because they're mostly Mexican Americans, right? Who live
right
there.
Right. That first trip, I was amazed at the people that met us. They're people from the Board of Education, and they had had a program for us and lunch at the junior high school, I think it was. And they put on a very good program. I mean, I couldn't believe how much effort they went into, you know, get that program together. And yes, but I understand the second trip, there were even more officials. Is that right, Shim?
Yeah, well, I think the important thing about Crystal City is that it's one of the, I don't know how rare, but it's one of the few Texas towns that has political power in the hands of Mexican Americans. And I think because of that, they were much more welcoming and generous in their offering up all of the amenities that they could while we were there. In my experience, especially with Tule Lake, we find a lot of hostility in the local area. And it's kind of because they're very conservative, redneck Trumpers, I guess.
Yeah, we're in Texas.
And so, you know, it's hard to make inroads, friendly inroads into those communities. But at Crystal City, they were like open arms. And when I went there with Victor Uno and Mitch Higa for a scouting trip, we met with all of the important people of Crystal City, the mayor, the city manager, the county judge. The county judge in Texas, I guess, are the most powerful local politicians. Mm-hmm. And the superintendent of schools, the school principal, they were all at a meeting to find out what we needed to do and help us in every way possible. They supplied all the chairs for the ceremony that we had. They cleaned up the pool area. It was just wonderful.
They smoothed the road there for the handicapped. They did things like that.
Wow.
The school was, that was one of the highlights of our trip, is to go to the, when you enter the school, there's this huge rotunda there, and they, the students, displayed, I don't know, it must have been over 100 photos of the camps. Some of them we've never seen before.
Wow.
You know, some of them I recognized. My nephew from LA that joined us, he said that was the first time he saw one photo of his dad. So it was that pretty special, the way they welcomed us with open arms. They put a lot of effort into that. And the good thing is that, especially because of Victor Uno and Shim, we've been in touch with the some of the people there, and we'll continue to stay in touch so that we could maybe plan our next pilgrimage perhaps for next year.
But didn't we hear some stories about during the war, they would like, did we have oranges and they didn't or something? There was some like trading of food through the fence with the Mexican-Americans. Although at that time, Shim, they were completely ruled by a white administration, right?
Yeah, I think in, I think it was in 1968 or so, they had this kind of revolution in Crystal City. And La Raza started there, and they were able to elect most of the supervisors and the mayor, but they worked for the big company, which was Del Monte, and Del Monte put pressure on them to stay, you know, basically stand down. And so their first effort at political organizing got thwarted by this big corporation. But they continue to work at it, and it's a town that the mayor, the city manager, the county judge are all Mexican Americans. So
didn't it start when there was like high school cheerleaders, and they wouldn't allow like a Mexican American cheerleader?
Yeah, they had a quota, I think, of one. One out of five. And then when one of the Caucasian cheerleaders quit, and they wanted to put in another Mexican girl, the principal said it was fine with him, the students were all for it, but then the school board said no. And then the school, the kids went on strike, and that basically was the genesis of their political organizing and resistance. Yeah, it's an inspiring story, and it's fitting that it was at Crystal City.
Well, and then the other thing is that was the first effort by what's now become rather a large organization, Sudo for Solidarity. It was kind of born on that first trip, and taking the cranes and hanging them on the fence. And then, you know, we went to different other, again, my memory, we went to, where's the border there, the Mexican border? And we hung cranes on the fence.
Laredo.
Laredo, right. And we met with immigrant women, children, and men in safe houses. It was packed, that trip.
Yeah.
And quite eye-opening. And we did go to the state legislature because most of them didn't even know about the history of Crystal City. so that was, you know, yeah,
it's that one short weekend, and we got trips to Crystal City, to Dilley, to Austin, to Laredo, and then, is it called Laredo on the other side of the border, the Mexican town?
Oh, shoot, we should know that.
I think so. Or New, I forget, but yeah, that all of that on one weekend. And,
it might be called Nuevo Laredo, like New Laredo or something, is on one side. And you know. Right. Oddly, you know, when we went to cross the border, it was a quiet day. There weren't a whole lot of people trying to cross the border. But remember on the Mexican side, the one refugee kind of family that we encountered were from Africa. Let's see, what country? They were French speaking.
Yeah, I think it was Senegal, wasn't it?
And they were waiting to cross the border. Yeah.
And then luckily one of our people, Claudia Katayanagi, she spoke French and was able to talk to them.
So. Yeah. But they didn't want their pictures taken.
So I'm going to interrupt and say we have a question from the audience. This is someone who knows Hiroshi Shim and Kaz. Ellen Hashiguchi, do you want to unmute yourself and ask them yourself and say hi?
I'm that teenage girl from across the bay in Berkeley who you used to drive to across the bay to pick us teenagers up to go to the church to have some fun dancing away. And I want to thank you for providing so much fun. But my question to you is, I was 16 at the time, and no one knew each other's background, what their experiences were in the camp. So my question to you, 68 years later, is when did you start your activism, and when did you feel comfortable actually talking about your life experiences in camp and how it affected you as a young person and as a teenager and maybe young adult growing up? So I'd like to hear from each one of you. I mean, because back then we weren't all that serious, right? But now you've taken a stance and now speak publicly and saying we were wronged and this shouldn't happen again. So when did
I'm
all
a
that
late,
come
latecomer.
Out?
Yeah, Ellen, no, good to see you, Ellen. I'm a latecomer. I mean, activism, it just started when I was went to Crystal City the first time. We were there twice the year 2019. So I'm a latecomer. But speaking about the family, the more I do this, the better I feel, because I want to, it's really for my parents' sake, my older siblings. They never got to speak out loud and tell the story. It would have been much better if they told it. And that's why I'm more than happy to be a part of a Zoom like this and other meetings and such. It's a story that still surprises so many people. They still don't know. And that's why this particular documentary, like I said, Emiko, people get it when they see this one. It's real clear to them. Even my nephew in LA, he's my oldest sister's son. So my oldest sister and I are 17 years apart. So he's already 65. And then he saw then becoming now, and he says, I understand now.
Aren't you playing?
After all these years, yeah. So anyways, I give it to Shim now and Hiroshi.
I became involved mid-90s, I guess. when I attended my first Thule Lake pilgrimage, and then repeated going. And by the second pilgrimage, I had joined the Thule Lake committee. And so I've been involved ever since. In around 2000, we started up from within the Thule Lake committee, a preservation committee. And the work that we did there resulted in Thule Lake becoming a National Historic Memorial as part of an executive order that George W. Bush signed that made it a part of the park system.
The same guy who signed my apology.
I became active in land use in San Francisco in the 80s. And I wasn't involved in the Japanese community to a large extent until the Japan Center was being proposed for demolition. And that's when I became more active in the Japantown issues. Prior to that, it was more trying to preserve the character of the neighborhoods for San Francisco, the different districts. But when the Japantown issue came up, Japan Center, I knew what the game plan was. I knew that the city wanted to demolish the center and put up housing, because housing was a, was a big deal for these speculators and the developers. So fortunately, as it turned out, it was not a good plan. So subsequent to that, that dragged on for such a long time. The Japantown planning, I think, lasted maybe 5, 6, 7 years or whatever. And so anyway, after that was over, I didn't get involved until Shim invited me to the trip to Crystal City. And and it was a pretty amazing trip. It's, it's this whole issue about the internment, that was something that people just didn't speak about. And then I guess it was the, after the reparations, and I have to admit that the whole process of that reparation, I didn't think it had a chance. I wasn't deeply involved. I was still too young. But the unfortunate thing was, after everything settled, the people who deserved that had all passed away. And here it was the young guys, the people who didn't have the hardship, that that benefit from it. So I was a little bit sad and disappointed that my father, my parents in that generation, didn't benefit. It's always a little late.
I think Hiroshi's father was probably the person that was incarcerated for the longest time during World War II, because he was arrested on Pearl Harbor Day, and he wasn't released until September of 1947 from the last concentration camp that America ran, which was Crystal City. So I'm pretty sure that he was the person that was incarcerated for the longest period of time.
Maybe by 1 year. I mean, maybe by one day, because other people other people like your dad? Are you?
No. My dad didn't get his first incarceration was at Temperan.
Okay.
Yeah, my grandfather actually was on that same train as your father from San Francisco to Missoula. But yeah, he died before we got out. So
yeah,
thank you.
I have to make one correction in the documentary because I only realized later, Hiroshi, that your father was yet in another camp. I think it was Fort Sam Houston. Is that possible?
Yes.
And we forgot to put it in there. Oh, right. Dear. And I know he was a bit of they would consider a troublemaker in those camps because he would be counseling people, telling them about their rights and the Geneva Conventions, and, you know.
When he went to Crystal City, they had some kind of, I'm not sure what it is, a letter or something for the camp directors that he was not to be in any leadership position, that he was, you know, not to cause trouble.
I think, yeah, the story that I heard was that he was instrumental at Santa Fe in preventing the administration from forcing the Japanese prisoners from working and breaking up rocks to create a road from the highway to the concentration camp. And he invoked the Geneva Accords that I think stated that they could only be made to work on jobs that would benefit them. And a road from the highway to the concentration camp is not anything that would benefit them. So they had to pull all those men off, and they were really angry. Can I use the word pissed? And
you mean the administration was pissed?
Yeah, and so when he wanted to reunite with his family at Crystal City, the condition that they put on it was that he couldn't become involved politically and especially become the group leader. And that benefited my father, because when we got there in 1946 from Tule Lake, we were part of about 350 renunciants that were transferred from Crystal City, from Tule Lake to Crystal City. He became the group spokesman, but you know, that was because Reverend Fukuda couldn't be.
I'm going to just interrupt for a second to thank you guys. This is so fantastic. It is 9 o'clock. And so just going to give people a chance to sign off if they want.
Ask you a question.
Yeah.
This is Ellen. Uh-huh. You know, I put it in the chat, but you know, as a filmmaker and photographer, looking at all the footage that's been collected over the years, you see a lot of the camp life where people are dancing to jazz music, they're playing baseball, they're dancing. It looks like they have a lot of arts and crafts for the people that are interned. You know, we know that all happened because of the Japanese community providing an atmosphere where for the young people to maintain some kind of normalcy in camp. But I'm just wondering what you think the perception is, would be of a white person, a non-Japanese person on the outside, looking at all this footage and saying, well, those people had a pretty good life. They got fed, they didn't have to do any work, you know. Do you think there's like a mixed message that could be perceived by people who wanted to look at our incarceration as not being so bad?
Well, I wouldn't even call it a mixed message. It was the government was trying to make it look like we were getting like treated well.
Yes.
And they, because they had to sell the concept of putting us all away to the public. Mm-hmm. And I think that they got themselves into trouble in several ways. But the photograph, you know, many of the photographs you see in the National Archives, they were taken by the government with like military photographers came out there. But because they were kind of stuck between two places. One is they're trying to say like, look at, we're being treated well, you know, having a great time. And you know, cameras were relatively new in those days. So when somebody showed up with a camera, they would usually say smile, or you sort of smiled, you know, that's just what you did. But then when it came to trying to close the camps down, they'd also painted this picture of us being dangerous, you know, spies, traitors, not trustworthy. They had painted that kind of picture. And so to get us out of camp became another dilemma for the government. So up came the questionnaire saying that if you sign this to say you're loyal, blah, 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 you can get out, as though that was going to change the perception of all, you know, like when you went into a hostile community, you know, because many of the states did not want to take us right when the war started. We couldn't even move anywhere in the Western United States. The governor said, no, if they're too dangerous for California, we don't want them here, except for Colorado. The governor of Colorado, whose name I can't remember. But, you know, so it's like we were caught in this sort of thing, and they were caught about how to, you know, get us out of camp, because it was costly and completely unnecessary. When things like people got killed in camps and stuff, that was kind of bad press. And, you know, anyway, so when I say I don't think that there was there was any mix-up, from the government's perspective, I think they had a very particular point of view. Now, you do get lots of other photographs, like life photographers came in, you know, other sources. But to me, the most honest sources are those home movies. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm just like so grateful somebody had a camera in there, both stills and motion picture footage. But then you also get both sides of it. You got the horrible windstorms, but we were trying to keep a community together. So we did have mochitsuki. We did, you know, these are all things that are amazing to me. Like, my gosh, how'd they get all that stuff in there, and rice and, you know, all these things, the sumo and all. So yes, it was a community trying to remain a community and, you know, have some sanity. So they, right from assembly centers, people started having art classes, and, you know, things got, I mean, you get a bunch of people who are hardworking folk and you put them in all these places, like, they're not going to just sit around. Mm-hmm. I'm always amazed at how early all these kinds of things started. Mm-hmm. And I don't even know how they got things in there. Like, there would be like kabuki, like dances and stuff. They had costumes and, you know, when you spend a number of years in those places, I think either, you know, people send them to you or you make them, and lots of things were handmade. Like when they had funerals and stuff, they made paper flowers. You know, so people.
So was it a prerequisite to get out of camp that you say, said yes, yes on the questionnaire?
Well, yes, because otherwise you'd be deemed disloyal. And so then you needed to, you know, then you would be probably shipped to Tule Lake. Now, not everybody who was disloyal did, because our family didn't go, even though we were going to be, we're not renunciates, so see, we were going to go back to Japan, or our family. So, but for some reason we didn't go to Tule Lake. When you wanted to go out before the questionnaire, there was also another questionnaire that you had to fill out. It was, I think, called leave clearance or something like that. And there you had to answer a bunch of questions about your behavior. You're not going to gather together. You're not going to speak Japanese. If you're going to, and you had to check in to like a parole board. And then you had to have a job. Mm-hmm. And I think some of you saw maybe this movie Minari, mm-hmm. that won many awards. Well, you know, he was a chick sexer. Well, that's what a lot of people from the camps went, because the Japanese introduced chick sexing into this country. Or I don't know if they actually introduced it into this country, but they certainly kind of like, you know, got into like a routine, because I guess they must have had to do that before that was introduced. I don't know. I don't really, haven't studied the history of chick sexing, but I know that a lot of JAs went to work in those places. You know, and come to realize, I read some article about it recently, that it was started by Japanese from Japan. Yeah. And so, of course, there was a place you could go to get a job. And another one was that, let's see, what was that called? Sea something, that big farm that had frozen fruits and vegetables.
Seabrook.
Seabrook, right. There was another, is because they were hiring like cheap labor and, no, I'm sorry, I got off the track about chick sexing. So, anyway, but I remember seeing it in Minari going,
right.
Yeah.
So we have a couple of...
I just put a thank you in the chat. I am 40, but my grandparents were in Tanforan and Topaz, and my uncle and aunt were born there, but my dad was not. But all my life, I've been trying to make sense of this. So I really enjoy watching your movies and listening to your stories, because it helps me make sense of it. And it's very powerful to me. So I feel very connected to the community and to my grandparents who are not here anymore. And I really appreciate that. Thank you. Thank you so much.
My two older brothers were Kibes. They were in Japan from 1934 to 1939. During that period, Japan was at war, or began war in Manchuria, and wanted to recruit as many young people, including the Niseis that were in Japan, to join the Japanese military. Many of the Kibes at that time then refused to join the Japanese military because they were American citizens. They fought hard to prove that they were American citizens. And surprisingly, the Japanese government accepted that, didn't put them into jail or confine them, but allowed them to continue with their Japanese language. Then come Pearl Harbor, and then Executive Order 9066, and all persons are, including U.S. citizens, were not even recognized by our own government, but put everybody, including 80% of the 120,000 that were U.S. citizens, into these camps. So that's why my oldest brother was 22, and Topaz, when the loyalty questionnaire came out, he tried to encourage people to answer the two loyalty questions, 27 and 28, no, as a form of protest, right, to the U.S. government for putting Japanese, including citizens, into these camps, when in Japan they accepted the fact that they were U.S. citizens. So I just want to say that, did you realize, and that's why a lot of Kibes voted no and tried very actively to, in the different camps, to convince people to answer it in the negative. And in fact, I have a written FBI report that my brother got as a result of his activities in Topaz. And it does say in that FBI report that my brother did it as a form of protest and did not want to repatriate or be sent back to Japan as it was. Did you know this kind of information that is out there, any of you?
Yes, a lot of people found it as a form of protest. And the thing is, you could leave it blank, say, well, then, you know, they can't arrest me or whatever because I haven't said anything. Well, that was taken as a no. The interpretation of no was quite broad. I mean, like renunciates in Rabbit in the Moon, Hiroshi Kashiwagi says, we did that as a form of protest, not kind of knowing the full story of what was going to happen to them if they like gave up their citizenship. There was a lot of protest in the camps. And that's the other thing we just don't know about. And we're trying to compile a list of all the things that took place in all the different camps, especially around the draft. So that was the other next big thing that came through that was another divider of our community.
Yeah, thank you.
So a comment that Masako made, and maybe Kaz, you can address this, and she's interested in learning more about the Latin American Japanese, what happened to them, where they are now, did any of them return to South America, or did they all stay in the U.S., and how did they get legal since they had no passports? And Kaz, I think you're going to be speaking on another panel, and I'm not sure if that happened yet.
Next week with Janum, they're having a Zoom thing. Can't tell you, you know, Grace Shimizu would be a better source to answer mm-hmm. that question, but a large majority went to Seabrook, like Emiko said. There was a job there, there was a way to get out, get sponsorship, because they sponsor the families. That's another reason way you can get out of the camp. And they worked there, and you know, I guess eventually it was Bird's Eye, the brand that they were working for. But anyways, that's how they got out. In our case, Reverend Fukuda said that he'll be the sponsor for not just my family, but many other Japanese Peruvian families. And when we actually got out, and he arranged this with Wayne Collins, we were then all given individual families that sponsored us. Reverend Fukuda coordinated all of that, and that's how we got out and we were able to stay. We would have to report in the beginning, I think it was almost every month, and then after that annually to the immigration office to say that we're still here. And that was, I can remember those days. Everything took a long time to go through just that, you know, just to check in. My brothers and sister all eventually became US citizens. I was the last one. My mom and dad, of course, there's no way they could have gone through that. My dad was already 56 years old when we were got out of camp. And so, and like Hiroshi Fukuda said, you know, they didn't see any money for the reparation. They passed away. And so it was pretty hard for them. And yet they were able to be somewhat successful, you know? Yeah. And I think some families did go back. Some went to Canada, if I'm not mistaken, some went back to Japan, but we were told not to do that. The Peruvian government didn't want us, so we decided to stay, not knowing what's going to happen, but that was our best choice, and I think it was, in retrospect, our best choice.
Okay. No, one thing I, you know, since the Little Rabbit was earlier on. You know, I attached the atomic bomb to the end of Little Rabbit. It didn't appear in Rabbit, Big Rabbit, but you know, I do feel that because they could drop the bomb because we were not a white country, that we were an Asian country and or a non-white country. And my kind of thinking about that was, there's a filmmaker named Peter Watkins, and he made a film for the Brits. It was a BBC film. I forgot to research this so I could have it fresh in my memory, but he made a film called War Games. I think it was like in the 70s or something like that. And it was about an atomic bomb falling on a town in the UK. And after he finished it, the BBC decided it was too horrifying for their audience to see it. So I thought, well, they had seen pictures of Japanese that had been burned up in Hiroshima. So like, what was the, you know, why couldn't they show white people and certainly people like themselves? Because it was took place in the UK. So that was just a clue to me that because we were non-white, it was easier to make the decision to drop the bomb on our country, or I guess my ancestors' country. And so I, that was my thinking about the very end of Little Rabbit, which no one really much talks about, but I think it was a racist act on top of everything else.
So we have Sadako Kashiwagi here. Sadako. I'm going to put her on and she can talk if you want to unmute yourself.
Okay, you're unmuted.
Hi. Hi, Sadako.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for a very powerful program. And I just wanted to comment about the resistors and, you know, about Hiroshi being one of the resistors. And then also my father turns out to, and did Hiroshi, Shimizu sent me this thing and he read this to me and he read all these facts and he says, and his name is Junichi Nimura. Do you know him? And I says, yes, that's my father. And it turns out he was the first one arrested on the no-no question. And not only that, he was very vocal and active in the farmer's strike, and he helped. He was a handyman, so he helped finish the barracks. So when they struck, he was right there also. So you know. There's quite a history there.
Well, Tule Lake, there's quite a history there. And yes, one of the reasons that we only barely mentioned it in Rabbit is because that was like the whole other story. I mean, that could be a series. I know Barbara Takei, I think they're writing a book. So I keep telling Barbara, hurry up and finish this. and Conrad... what's called?
Adner.
Yeah, he made a very good documentary about, but it's so complicated. Mm-hmm. So you know, but yes, yeah, that was a very special camp.
And he was taken by the FBI to Santa Fe, sent to Santa Fe. My father.
And yeah, and he was protesting the registration, and speaking about it, and that was his crime, was that he openly spoke about not registering, that it was basically un-American to be asked to fill out a questionnaire when no one else was.
And, especially and since that, excuse me.
Yeah, and for that he was arrested by the FBI and taken to Shark Park, right? First. and then to Santa Fe. So the first Tule Lake protester to be arrested. That's the kind of stock that Sadako comes from.
But well, that's only part of the story. Oh yeah, he was into bootleg sake and everything too.
See, there are lots of stories about the camps we want to know about.
No, this was before the war.
Oh, before the war, during Prohibition. Okay. I think there was a lot of bootleg liquor in camp too.
Yeah, that too. My mother made it.
Here's another kind of stunning contrast. There's a movie called The Garden, and it took place, it's all archival footage. And this is, to me, kind of the whole contrast. We're in the camps, and this thing is taking place at Madison Square Garden. Now, I don't know if it was exactly the time we were in camp, but somewhere in the vicinity there. And it's all archival footage of a huge Nazi rally at Madison Square Garden at around the same time that we're being incarcerated and stuff. And they didn't have to answer like loyalty questions and stuff like that. You know, I mean, there were some Germans and Italians also gathered up, but usually they had hearings and got out, you know. So
you may hear a real coincidence that the guy that led those big rallies in Madison Square Garden, he was the head of the American Bund, after war was declared against Japan, and then also all of the other Axis forces, Germany became the enemy. So they arrested the leader, Fritz, I forget his name, but he was taken and he was in Crystal City.
Oh, well, there it is, another story.
And he tried to take over leadership of Crystal City, but the other Germans wouldn't let him.
Jill, Emiko, just in case I black out my batteries.